In the last video we looked at the first chapter of the Epistle to the Hebrews. In it, the author warns the readers to avoid worshiping angelic beings rather than Christ, and ends by reminding them that those angelic beings serve Christ. They minister to him. In the second chapter of the Epistle, the author reminds the readers that God has not subjected the world to angels, to the angelic beings. Who indeed has God subjected the world to? For that, the author turns to the book of Psalms, to Psalm 8. What is man that you are mindful of him, of the Son of Man that you cared for him? You made him a little lower than the angels. You crowned him with glory and honor, putting everything in subjugation under his feet. It seems as if the author implies that it's humanity to whom the world is subject. It's humanity that's supposed to rule the world on God's behalf, but then he points out that this does not seem to be the case. The world seems out of control. The world seems broken, damaged, storms rage, fires burn, tyrants rise, all to the disadvantage of the human race. He relates this back to Christ. Christ has come and fulfilled the prophecy in Psalm 8. He is a human being, the Son of Man, who has been made a little lower than the angels, but then crowned with glory and honor. Now everything is put under his feet, under Jesus' feet. How did that happen? The author tells us that Jesus does this through becoming perfect, through suffering. He says that Jesus has been crowned with glory and honor because of the suffering of death, so that through the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. Jesus, therefore, unites himself in brotherhood with all human beings. That's his goal. That's his ultimate goal. He is there to unite himself with everyone, to unite everyone through his sufferings to God. That is why he is not ashamed to call them brethren, brothers. He is not ashamed to call human beings brothers and sisters, to call us family with God as our Father, because out of his love for us, he came to join us back together with God. This points to the centrality of human beings to God's plan. Jesus came to earth not to save angels or angelic beings or spiritual creatures, but to save human beings like you and me and bring humanity back to God, to bring humanity out of the jaws of death. In the second chapter of the book of Hebrews, the author reminds us, for surely not with angels that he is concerned, but with the descendants of Abraham, the people of God. We are the reason God has come into the world. We are the reason God has entered into the world. He has come to save us from death, to save us from ourselves. Why? So that we can be one family under God the Father. In other words, so that we can understand true worship and we can participate in true worship. Thus, the Epistle of Hebrews ends on this note. He has made us like his brothers and sisters, his brother in every respect, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in the service of God to make expiation for the sins of the people. This is all about our worship of God. Jesus has come to earth so that we might give God worship, right worship. He has come to be a high priest, to lead the congregation of the people of God, to lead the congregation of the spiritual descendants of Abraham into right worship.